Clear prop.
Star 73, Yankee number 2, following Flynn traffic, 3 mile final. Clear custom. 1 Charlie Bravo, Lakeford in runway 25, going 4 mile final.
This is Behind the Prop with United Flight Systems owner and licensed pilot Bobby Doss, and his co-host, Major Airline Captain and designated pilot examiner Wally Mulhern. Now let's go Behind the Prop.
What's up, Wally?
Hey, Bobby, how are you?
Fantastic as always. This week, based on some things you've seen and a huge milestone you have reached, we're going to talk about aeronautical decision-making today. Before we started recording, you shared with me that you've done 1,000 check rides. I can only imagine the aeronautical decision-making you've seen over 1,000 check rides.
Yeah, it was, obviously I keep track of check rides on a yearly basis just for my records. There was a time where to renew our designation, we had to provide actual numbers to the FAA. And now that we've come into a little bit more of an automatic tracking system, we don't have to do that anymore. But I still keep track of it. And it was 1,000 check rides. Just actually the last check ride I gave, which thanks to the weather here in Houston, was 2 weeks ago. So I probably had about 12 others scheduled that have all been canceled. And hopefully tomorrow we're going to get back in the air and start certifying some pilots to go out.
We all hope so.
Yeah.
So we're not just talking about aeronautical decision-making. We're talking really about how instructors are teaching aeronautical decision-making. Maybe some tips from your perspective on how we can teach it better, maybe to make it stick a little bit more, and maybe ways that we can use techniques to make better decisions ourselves, and talk through some of this. So you have a few ideas. I have a few ideas. How do you think people learn how to do aeronautical decision making?
Well, let me just preface this with there's so many resources out there nowadays for aspiring pilots or continuing pilots, but there are just so many electronic resources. There are so many books out there that are really, really good resources. But I always come back to three main books. And if I were to say I believe probably 85% of what we need to know as pilots comes out of three books. And one of them is the FARAIM. There's the rules. It's the rule book. We have the Airplane Flying Handbook, and then we have the PHAC, or the Pilot's Handbook of Aeronautical Knowledge. And in that book, if you look in that book, you pull out the PHAC, Chapter 1 is all about, it's kind of nice-to-know stuff, but it talks about how, the different levels of pilot certificates. It talks about the FAA, talks about the history of flight. Really, in Chapter 1, there's probably not a whole lot in there that is absolutely required to safely fly an airplane. So you go to Chapter 2, which is really the first meaty chapter of the book. It's aeronautical decision-making. So the FAA thinks it's pretty important. And what I see as an examiner is a lot of people have never made a decision. They never had to make a decision because their instructors have made the decision. So, as a private pilot, you're required to have 10 hours of solo time. And obviously, when they show up for a private pilot check ride, we look for that. And in some cases, we'll see 10 hours, and sometimes some cases you'll see a little bit more. But, that's 10 hours of supervised flying where, maybe they went up with their instructor, they did three or four landings, and then the instructor got out of the airplane, they went and did three or four landings. So maybe they log 1.2, 0.6 is solo. When they do their cross country, they have to have an endorsement to fly that cross country from a CFI. So they've consulted and they've gone out and flown this cross country. What I find very interesting is when applicants come in for their instrument rating, I'll look at their logbook totals, and by and large, most of them still have 10 hours of solo time or whatever they had when they got their private. And, of course, they have the required pilot and command time. And I'll ask them about that PIC time. I'll say, well, of this 50 hours of PIC time, who was in the airplane with you? And most of the time it's all, oh, it was my CFI, but I was, you know, doing the duties of pilot in command. Well, you can say that, but it's just not the same. It is just not the same. So now we've got someone who's coming in for an instrument rating, and then, you know, the next step is commercial. So here they are. They are now, you know, once they get their commercial, they're legal to go out and fly people around and make money at it, and they've never really had to make a decision.
Yeah, I remember the first big decision I had to make, of course, in flying, but I think it was a lacking thing in my early training of my CFI decided if we were going. I never was really involved in that decision making. He was a great CFI. I just don't think that we were too worried about that stuff in those days. So I remember getting to my private check ride and not being comfortable making the decision about the winds that day, right? Because I had never, I kind of knew what I had flown in, but I never had personal minimums. I didn't know what those, what I was really willing to fly in by myself, because somebody had always been there helping me make those decisions.
Right.
My decision maker was more along the lines of, did he feel comfortable in 12 knots of crosswind? Because I knew I could just let go. But come check ride day, it was a decision that I wasn't confident in making for sure. And I wish we would have done more to teach me how to make that decision for sure.
Right, right. You know, one scenario I will give on a check ride is a divert. Okay, we need to go to, we can't continue on to our destination because of a medical emergency. I'm having a medical emergency. I am in bad shape. I'm about to die. Okay, so they pick an airport and they head to it, and let's say maybe we're north of the airport and we're heading in toward that airport, and it might be 12 miles away, so it's going to take us about, I don't know, 7-8 minutes, something like that. And the wind is 360 at 5 knots. And by golly, we're gonna set up for a left downwind and turn around and land to the north. And I can't say it's wrong. It's not wrong. But usually during the debrief, I will say to the applicant, I'll say, did you consider landing straight in? And a lot of times I say, well, that's a tailwind. We can't land with a tailwind. I say, okay, well, they were calling the wind 010 at 5 knots. Let's look up in the POH to see what a 5-knot tailwind does to us. Oh, well, we need 1,400 feet of runway instead of 1,200 feet of runway. You know, and I will compare that to if we're driving down the road and I told you I was having a heart attack and we drove up to the hospital and there was the emergency room. We could see the sign for the ER and we couldn't really figure out how to get into the parking lot, but there was an exit only right there. Would you turn in the exit and get me to the emergency room? You know, of course, with no cars around or anything like that. And everybody says, oh, absolutely, I would. I said, well, okay, so we're going to, you know, break the rule in this case. And I think everybody on the planet would agree that that's the right case, the right choice to make. Can we land with a tailwind? So have as CFIs, have we ever taken our students out? And, you know, when you're at an uncontrolled airport with nobody around, or even if you're in a controlled airport with nobody in the traffic pattern, what about asking ATC, hey, can we turn around and can we land the other runway?
This tower would let you do it. I know for a fact that if you called and organized that, they would let you do that for sure.
Yeah, yeah. Now, you know, 360 at 25, gusting to 35, no, I'm not talking about that. But I'm talking about with just a small tailwind? Is that a skill that we should be imparting onto our students so that they have something in their toolkit? So now if they are in an emergency situation, at least they've done it, and there might be a confidence level. You know, when if someone came to me, I know you're a big golfer, Bobby. I mean, if someone came to me and said, or if I went to you and said, hey, would you teach me how to play golf? At some point, we're going to be out there at the driving range hitting balls. We're going to be on the putting green putting. We're actually, to learn how to play golf, you have to play golf. To learn how to make decisions, you got to make decisions.
Well, golf and sports are a great example because, you know, I could teach you how to hit balls on the range, but you're not going to have any decision making at that point.
Right.
But we're going to hit balls on the range, and you might learn that you can hit your 7 iron 135 yards, which might not be the quote unquote average, but until you get to where there's a pond in front of you and you have 120 yards to carry and you have a 7 iron in your hand, you're going to realize you can't hit that 7 iron 135 yards anymore because your mind's going to squeeze on you a little bit and you'll be a little tight and it's not going to get over the water.
My ball's going in the water.
For sure.
Or now, the trees.
If there's no water there, you're not going to hit it. You're going to hit it 135, right? So you got to be put in those situations to make those decisions. And as a rookie golfer, you might choose to go around that lake instead of going over that lake. And that's a really good example of the same things that you would decide to do.
Yeah.
And I think as instructors, we do use scenario-based training, but we don't use it to that next level of really talking through those things, giving those scenarios that are life and death that can't ever create the real stress that you would have in those situations, but they can create some of it. You can emulate those risk factors for sure.
You have to put your student under stress. Because when first of all, when they get to me in the check ride, they're under stress already. And you know, they do things that, well, they always tell me that they normally don't do this, but today they did. And you
the
know,
1 hour pre-flight.
Yeah. The sample size that I have is, well, that's the only pre-flight I've seen you do. And it took you about an hour, but we have to figure out a way to better stress our students. Perfect example. Okay. So you're walking out to the airplane. You're going to go fly. The weather's fine. All you're going to do is you're going to go out and you're going to do some, ground reference maneuvers. Then you're going to come back and you're going to do, short and soft field landings. It's going to be about an hour and a half flight or something like that. What about on the way out to the airplane, you say to your student, oh, by the way, yeah, I just talked to Freddie and he just flew this airplane. The right fuel gauge is inoperative, but we're going to have him top it off. Let's go. And see how your student reacts to it. And I would like to think your student would stop and say, wait a minute, fuel gauge, I don't think we can go with that. Or let's look it up. That's a very viable action. But I would bet if I were to take a straw poll, I would, you know, if people started doing that, I'll bet the majority of the students would just keep going because you're kind of telling them it's okay.
Mm-hmm.
And you know, you've made all the decision, and the fact that you keep walking, you're making the decision for the student. Now, yeah, true, you are the pilot in command as the CFI if it's a student pilot. But, you know, there's a situation of putting your student under stress. Or how about this? We're going to fly across country. We're going to go from airport A to airport B, and you actually have no intention of ever making it to airport B. We're going to have to divert. And we may divert to airport C, D, E, F. Who knows? But the student is not really prepared to go to one of those airports. But that might be what we need to do. I mean,
and that's always scary for new pilots to go somewhere they've never been before. So make sure that creates stress, right?
Right.
You know, you've guided them to the four airports within your practice area, probably. What about letting them them, forcing them, diverting them, whatever you have to do to get them to go somewhere that they've never been before. It can both be nerve-wracking and a little scary for that new pilot, but the sense of accomplishment that they feel when they do go to that first airport for the first time that they've never been to, that they're making that decision, probably is going to be a big win for them as a pilot.
Absolutely.
What other techniques like this? We've used a few examples, landing downwind, the diversion because you're having a heart attack, and maybe picking something. What about, I know you do some equipment failure stuff. I like the idea of the fuel gauge not working. It's in the presence of trying to create a decision for the student, right?
Right.
I felt like when I was a student, probably an instrument student, it was really the first time I felt like a real pilot because I was making the decision. This was late in my instrument training. My instructor probably had said 1,000 times, yeah, we can go in this. Yeah, we probably shouldn't go today. And I just always followed their lead. But I think I started coming to the airport deciding, no, today's the day we're going to go. We're going to fly this flight in actual. I want to do it. And I think we should go. And I know that he and I had enough of a relationship where he would either trust me. I don't think he ever overrode me, and I don't think he ever would have put me in a situation to get hurt. But how often do we guide those students towards the decision we want them to make instead of really challenging them? Do they have a risk plan, a way to make that decision? Are they doing anything to make the decision themselves?
Yeah.
I get a call the other day, a student called and said, what are the crosswinds? And they were trying to see if that met the minimums for them to come fly. I asked them what were their personal minimums, and then their personal minimums were within range. So I told them to come on. If he hadn't had made the decision about his own personal minimums, I didn't want the school's rules to dictate whether he went and flew or not. Right.
Right.
We should never be letting that happen as pilots.
Right.
Right. Any other techniques as an instructor that you might have used to put someone in a situation to make a decision to go or not to go?
Well, I think we need to think out of the box. I think we come into a flight school and maybe the flight schools give their presentation as to why you should come here and train, and I think they may say, we're going to teach you everything you need to know to be a professional pilot if you stay with us. And that's a little bit misleading because some of the people take it to the degree of, well, I can just let common sense go out the window. And that's not the case. That's not the case at all. I remember my first solo happened on December 7th, 1981 at 9:17 a.m., runway 4 in Monroe, Louisiana. I took off and the controller said, make right, close traffic. And that's when I realized I had never made right traffic in my life. I had done left traffic.
Feels different, doesn't it? Especially at 20 hours or whatever.
Yeah. Yeah. And I just remember thinking, well, I guess I turn right and right and right. And there's going to be the runway. Actually, 4 right turns. That was only 3, right? So I did it. And guess what? When I turned final, the runway was in front of me. And, that's the thing that my instructor and I kind of had a laugh about. Gee, I've never done right traffic. And for those of you especially who are that teach out of non-controlled airports, and, that may be the case. I mean, you take your student over to a controlled airport and they get their 3 landings over there. But it's possible that's never, your student's never done right traffic. So that's something to do. I mean, even if you're at a non-controlled airport and it is a left traffic airport and there's nobody else in the traffic pattern, let's give them some right traffic and explain to them, hey, it's a little bit differently. So just, force your students to make decisions and go with it. Let them go with it. If they pick, airport C and you really wanted to go to airport D because they had better burgers, well, just let them go with it. The other thing is, Where do your students go on cross-country trips? I mean, do you basically tell them where to go? I think that's probably what most of the flight schools do, because I see the same places in the logbooks. How about let the student pick? And of course, you've got ultimate authority. I mean, if they pick an airport that has a 600-foot grass strip, you might want to come back and say, well, no, you're not going there. And you certainly have that prerogative to do that. But
what if I said Houston to O'Hare?
Yeah. Probably not where we want to go.
Unrealistic.
Yeah, yeah. Or you know, Houston to DFW. I mean, that's within range of our airports. Okay, do you really want to go into DFW on a 172? You're probably going to pay about an $800 landing fee to land there, and you're going to pay about $12 a gallon for avgas. So, you know, let that student make the decision. You know, suppose it's an airport you've never been to. Well, good for the student.
I think there's a lot of maintenance things. As a guy who owns a fly school and sees a lot of maintenance things, I think it's a great opportunity to teach people some tolerances around maintenance, right? COM2's not working. Should we go or not go?
Yeah. Yeah.
There's a lot of reasons why I could say I might not go, and there's a lot of reasons why I say I might go. Overcast 2000, I might not take that aircraft if
right.
it's not got a second nav radio. Or maybe Nav1's out, or sorry, COM1 and Nav1 are out, which is my GPS. I'm probably not going to go in 2000 overcast with just one nav radio and one radio. Just no need to go practice that day in that condition. But then the question says, okay, well, what if my CDI, let's just say my attitude indicator is not working? Do we go? Do you want to go? I can see where a perfectly clear day VFR flight might not be a valuable lesson to that student if the attitude indicator is not working.
Yeah.
But assuming we're working on steep turns or something in that example, but it might be a really good day to teach them how to use the compass.
Yeah.
If their attitude indicator is not working and it's a somewhat windy day, but perfectly clear, that thing spinning might drive you nuts. They might need to learn how to get a suction cup little thingy to put over it to ignore it. Right.
Yeah.
There's a lot of opportunity, but if you say, hey, we can go, their bias is going to be made. This guy over here is telling me we should go. I don't know if I should go. That's kind of some of those opportunities we can make
right.
or create for our student. Just cover it up and say, do you think this lesson's one you want to do with this instrument not working today?
Right.
They're going to experience that throughout their training.
Yeah.
What if the turn coordinator isn't working? What are we supposed to do? The student pilot's going to say, yeah, let's send it because they want to go fly.
Right.
But okay, we can send it. I'm willing to go with you, student, but what do we got to do? What are the rules?
Right. Well, we got to make sure that it's not required, and assuming it's day VFR, it's not. But we have to mark it, and we have to disable it, because most airplanes, the turn coordinator is electric. So I think we have to realize when something electric is not working, we need to really figure out if it's just not working or if there's an electrical issue. I mean, there could be a short, you know, a light bulb is a good example. We have a burnt out, we have a nav light that's not working. Is it because the bulb is burned out or is there a short going out to it in the wiring, which goes right by the fuel tank, by the way?
It might be dripping.
Yeah, yeah.
Or overfilled. That might not have a problem. It might just be overfilled.
Right.
That could be a problem.
Right.
I wouldn't check the nav lights five times on that day.
Yeah.
For sure.
So that, you know, there's an example too. You know, you're going out with your student and, you know, it's a day flight and you throw out, oh, by the way, the right nav light's not working on this airplane. I'll see you at the airplane. You know, maybe see how the student reacts to that.
I try to make it happen a lot, but I know it doesn't happen enough. But I like to create some of these things for people. And an example would be, what if the flap handle just had an in-op sticker on it when you were in your 11th hour of flight training, right? You get out to the plane, the instructor's not out there, you're pre-flighting, and you see an in-op sticker. what would you do in that situation? You'd have to start. And it said, do not move by order of the manager of the FBO.
Right.
What are you going to still pre-flight the plane? There's got to be some decision making that occurs there. Right.
Right.
I think CFIs can create those things that really make people ask questions.
Yeah.
And if the CFI comes out there and goes, yeah, they're inoperative, I've been flying this plane all day, do you want to go?
Yeah.
I think the students got to decide, can they fly a plane with not working flaps?
Right.
You know, a lot of people don't realize planes exist without flaps.
Yep.
they make planes without flaps. So it's doable.
Yeah.
But have you ever thought about it? Do you know how to look up the numbers on what a no flap landing would look like?
Right. Right. And some of the airplanes have data for it. A lot of older airplanes do not have data for it.
It's not going to be shorter, though.
Right.
Newsflash. Right. It's not going to take you less runway. Right. But that might make your slip skills get better by doing that. You might have to think through things. So let's talk about some techniques. Those were ways you might teach better decision making. But let's just say if we're on our own, what are the techniques we use for aeronautical decision making? Most of us have heard the phrase or the acronym PAVE, and we probably use PAVE for the pilot, the aircraft, the environment, and external pressures. Those probably learn that by lesson 5 or 6, right?
Yeah.
Other things that might help us with our decision making or analysis of our decision making. There's a tool called FRAT, a FRAT tool from the FAA. All you got to do is go search for FRAT. I think we've talked about this in the past, but it's the flight risk assessment tool. It has a lot of questions, but it kind of takes you from zero risk to extreme risk based on yourself and all those things that are kind of in PAVE. I know a pilot that works for your airline gave me a card once that was on the back of his lanyard, and it was kind of, it had a little bit of decision making, and it kind of had the debrief on it, something he probably got a new hire or something, but it kind of had a decision-making tool at the top, and then the debrief checklist that you would have. What could we do better? Or what could we have changed different on this flight? You know, this is real world stuff, right? Y'all have to have some decision-making before you go.
Yeah. Well, we use it on every flight. On one, the front side is the briefing and the back side is the debriefing. I mean, the first thing we do is we, you know, as a crew, we say, what are our threats tonight? Personal, how's everybody doing? You know, somebody may just say, hey, I just found out my mother has terminal cancer. Okay, so, your mind may be wandering a little bit tonight or today. We talk about the environmental, you know, and usually the main thing when we say environmental, we're talking about the weather, but there could be terrain. You know, I take off from Hawaii a lot to the north, and to the east is big mountains. So, you know, that's part of our briefing, the environmental. And then technical, you know, is anything, you know, anything going on the airplane that we need to, you know, factor in? Do we have a anti-skid system that's inoperative, or the reverser that's going to cause us to use a little bit more runway on landing when we get to wherever we're going? So we do this, and it's done every flight. This isn't just a once a month type thing or a once a day thing. Every flight we actually go through and go through all that.
Yeah, I don't think you have to use the FRAT tool for a few laps in the pattern, but you've got to start learning how to make those decisions somehow in some way. I think our chief does a really good job of teaching people that there's really three scenarios that he thinks about, or three colors. It's green, yellow, and red. And everything can be green, yellow, or red. We can think about the weather. Is the weather in a green state, a yellow state, or a red state? And I can say, for me, when I was flying instrument and in the clouds every couple of weeks in a 182, I would have said 4,000 overcast was all green for me. Would have had no issues taking off in 4,000 feet overcast. Today, not flying as often in IMC, it would be a red for me. I would not feel comfortable. I would not take my wife in that.
Right.
And so I think it can be the environment or the thing that you're talking about, but based on your currency, recency, and skill set might change that to a different color, right?
Yeah.
The flaps not working might be green if I've done a week of training with my CFI on skids and slips to land, and I'd had no issues practicing that.
Right.
But if I've not done a no-flap landing and I'm going into a 600-foot grass strip,
yeah,
I probably need to think about that in a very different light than a 7,000-foot concrete runway.
And think about this. I mean, we do risk analysis in everything we do. I mean, right now we got a lot of rain going on in Houston and flooding, and there's street flooding. And, you know, if someone said to me, hey, could you take me to this part of town and it's the other part of town, I mean, I'm going to be looking at the flooding situation. Are roads flooded? Can we even get there? So we, you know, just driving on the road, we do risk assessment. You know, it's a pouring down rainstorm. Are we going to fly the speed limit? Or maybe we're going to drive the speed limit. Or maybe we're going to drive 10 miles per hour slower.
Yeah.
Maybe that's, you know, what we need to do. You know, one thing I will ask on check rides, I haven't done it in a while, but I'll throw out a scenario. I said, okay, you're going from here to there, and it's 200 miles away. Okay, and we're going to say it's a two-hour flight, and there is not a cloud in the sky. Weather is not an issue whatsoever. And we're halfway. We're 100 miles into the flight. We've flown for an hour. We've got an hour to go. And the number two communication radio stops working. It doesn't work anymore. What are we going to do? I'll give them four choices. Answer A is land in a field. Answer B is continue. Answer C is turn around. And answer D is divert. I would like to think that all of us think that A is not a viable option. Landing in a field over a failed number two radio is probably not what we want to do. But you could make an argument for continuing, turning around, or diverting. I probably wouldn't divert, but there might be more scenario, you know, more information needed to make a valuable assessment. But there's a question just to throw out when you're sitting at the airport on a Saturday morning and the weather's bad and everybody's sitting around, you're talking, and you know, everybody's telling war stories. Just throw that out there and see what the different responses are. You know, a lot of people say, I'm going to keep going. Well, and someone may say, well, I'm going to divert because I'm not sure if it's really a radio problem or a problem with the electrical system. Okay, great thought. Okay, I can't argue with that. You know, someone says, I'm going to turn around, go to my where I departed from because I know the avionics guy. I can get it fixed. So it's just a discussion. None of them are wrong answers, but just something to think about.
Yeah, I'll tell one story to that because COM2 went out on a plane that someone was renting one time. And really, they were in Galveston. If you're in Houston, that's about 35-minute flight, and they said that the radio stopped working and they could smell something, like an electronic burning smell, right? No smoke, but they could smell something. And they were going to leave the plane. They wanted me to send somebody down there to pick them up. And I thought, yeah, that plane's going to be stuck down there for a while. Who knows how deep and wide this goes. But I called my mechanic, and he said, just see if they can get an Allen wrench and get the radio out, get COM2 out. And sure enough, they got COM2 out and they could, you know, smell the radio, and there was a hint of some smell. And he said, tell them to start the plane and see if the smell comes back, right? Just turn the master switch on. No smell, nothing happened. He says, 99% of the time it's contained the radio. Have them go do a run up. If they feel comfortable, tell them to fly back with one radio. And if they don't, tell them to stay and we'll come figure it out. Well, they took the radio out, couldn't smell anything, flew the plane back with one radio. And it was not an issue. But if you hear that first, that you smell something that has this burning smell,
right,
you might really make a... And now they were on the ground. So again, all kinds of scenarios where you make different decisions. But as a rookie fly school owner, I thought we were done for. I figured that plane was sitting down there for a week. Who knew?
Right.
But yeah, take the radio out. It was a non-issue. We plugged a new radio in and it had no issue. threw the other one away. It just, it is what it is. I think every scenario teaches you how to make better decisions because you're put in those scenarios and have to make them, even if you're a flight school owner or a renter of an aircraft.
Right.
I think the hero book, it's out there. There is a hero book out there for doing all this. And it's the Risk Management Handbook from the FAA, just like the Pilot Handbook of Aeronautical Knowledge. They have a Risk Management Handbook, and it's really good stuff. If you're interested in figuring out how you can make better decisions, better aeronautical decision-making, this book's 80 pages of gold as it relates to aeronautical decision-making. And if you haven't ever reviewed it, it's a free book. Your tax dollars have paid for it. Just go out to the FAA website, look for their aviation handbooks, and you'll find it and can download a copy and should have it on your electronic flight bag for sure.
Yeah.
Well, tomorrow's going to be a good day. Hopefully, we're going to get some check rides in. We have five scheduled, so hopefully all five are successful. No matter what you're doing tomorrow, make sure you fly safely and stay behind the prop.
Thanks for checking out the Behind the Prop podcast. Be sure to click subscribe and check us out online at behindtheprop.com. Behind the Prop is recorded in Houston, Texas. Creator and host is Bobby Doss. Co-host is Wally Mulhern. The show is for entertainment purposes only and is not meant to replace actual flight instruction. Thanks for listening, and remember, fly safe.